HarperCollins presents The Very Merry Murder Club, edited by Serena Patel and Robin Stevens.
SHOE-DUNNIT by Elle McNicoll. Ballerinas are extremely difficult to kill. As someone who took a special interest in ballet, Briar knew this. She knew they were great athletes. She knew they put their bodies through the absolute extreme in order to give an incredible performance. However, it was not just their fitness and strength that made them difficult to harm. It was also their nature. They were, in Briar's opinion, the most incredibly humble type of people. A competitive industry full of hard-working, sensitive and generous dancers. Posy Lennox was not that kind of ballerina. She was, in that regard, exceptional. Briar's parents owned the most in-demand inn in Aviemore, and their 11 guests were currently snowed in while they were stuck in Inverness. Briar had managed to avoid the high-maintenance 20-something former ballerina and her small but intense entourage. Their only run-in had been when Briar was waiting in the corridor upstairs to perform her housekeeping tasks. The party of three had all left Posy's room together. Posy, her mother Renee, and Posy's publicist and manager, Marianne Hobson. Posy and her mother had adjoining rooms, and Marianne was next to them, whether she liked it or not. They passed Briar as she prepared to go in and clean.
"Strange little duck," Renee had said quietly.
"Creepy more like,"
Posy snorted, not as quietly.
"I heard there's something weird about her."
Marianne had given Briar an apologetic smile, patting her on the head as they all left. Briar stood alone in the corridor and let the remarks fade away like cigarette smoke. Briefly unpleasant, stinging her incredibly sensitive nostrils, but gone almost as soon as they had arrived. Briar's nose was infamous. She could give her own hound a run for his money. She made the beds in their rooms and avoided the urge to straighten their makeup bottles and organise their personal items. The next run-in was later that evening, when Briar and Flute were setting up the dining room for dinner. Posy stomped down the staircase and began to berate Jean-Claude at the front desk. "Loud for such tiny feet," Briar said to Flute, her basset hound, who was never far from her side. The little girl and the wrinkly dog watched the ballerina, now celebrity, as she launched into a tirade. It was true. Her feet were absolutely tiny. Smaller than Briar's, even with 20 years between them.
"Do you know how many Insta followers I have?" Posy barked at the man behind the front desk.
Briar gulped, exchanging a look with Flute. They both knew Jean-Claude's temper. Posy Lennox was perhaps about to meet her match.
"I don't care," Jean-Claude said coolly. "We have all been stuck here for days, listening to your tantrums, and I am sick of it. Tell your little followers I do not care."
"That's no way to speak to any customer, let alone me," shouted Posy, filling her lungs with air and standing right up on the toes of her tiny feet. "One word from me to my fans and this place will be tainted for the rest of its sad little life. Do you know who I am?"
"Sadly, I do,"
Jean-Claude snapped back, pulling himself up to his full height.
"You're a has-been ballerina. Now get out of my reception area before I wring your neck. Post your little review. See what happens. Je pourrais être tueur."
Briar knew Jean-Claude's threats were often empty, but he was angrier than she had ever seen him. A rational person might have chosen to step away, but Posy Lennox was no rational person, and her mother Renee looked every bit as enraged. The two stood side by side like furious salt and pepper shakers, ready to take the man to task. Let's all just take a moment to breathe, shall we? Marianne, the publicist, appeared at the side of her client and her client's mother. Her face and voice serene, her eyes warm and understanding.
He called me a has-been, shrieked Posy.
However, she did allow Marianne to steer her into the dining room.
I want him sacked.
Oh, lovely, Marianne said, picking up the little paper menu on their usual table. French onion soup. Just like old times, Pose. Might be as good as matron's.
Briar continued her task of placing water jugs on each table, taking care to look as though she had no interest in their conversation. But Briar's hearing was as refined as her nose, making eavesdropping not only easy, but sometimes completely unavoidable. Martin Herriot, a travel writer for a broadsheet newspaper, sat just behind the three ladies. His piece on Highland hospitality would hopefully not be spoiled by the unexpected extended stay. He made no effort to hide the fact that he was watching and listening to everything they did and said.
When you let me manage you, Renee spoke to her daughter, in a tone of voice Briar imagined she had been using for about 20 years. We won't elect to stay in places like this. We can opt for more privacy.
It was clear that this was a discussion they had had many times before.
I've told you, snarled Posy. I've told you, Mother, that you're not going to manage me. I can barely stand sharing a room with you, let alone working with you.
Briar winced. Martin Herriot whistled quietly. The two old ladies who liked to play cards at dinner kept their eyes glued firmly to the aces and queens in their hands, but their lips were pursed tightly in disdain.
Rude! Jean-Claude shouted from the reception desk before storming into the kitchens.
Posy, you're being awful, Renee said in a dangerously quiet tone.
When Briar's own mother chose a softly angry voice rather than a shouty one, Briar knew it was time to run. Posy typed furiously on her mobile phone, ignoring the weighted disapproval filling the room like mustard gas.
Review posted, she declared loudly, slamming her smartphone down on the table with a triumphant look. And I'll be speaking to your manager when it's finally possible to check out of this dump.
She threw a look of poison towards Briar and Flute.
And there shouldn't be animals in the dining room.
Briar looked out of the large bay window. She could see heaps of snow outside refusing to budge and still falling in defiant little flurries. Little did Briar know that this was the last night Posy Lennox would spend at the inn. Briar woke up at the witching hour. It was instantly clear why. Her hearing, better than Flute's at that moment, had picked up arguing and shouting from above. Briar's room was on the ground floor. She knew which guest had their room directly above her. Those small feet were stomping around and Posy's angry words carried all the way downstairs. Statements like, "Rather die than continue working with you," were bandied about before Posy's mother shrieked so loudly, Flute startled awake and almost fell off the edge of Briar's bed. Briar slipped from under her covers and moved to her door, opening it ajar to listen.
"Something's going to happen," she told Flute stoically.
Posy's mother could be heard yelling about ingratitude before thumping footsteps alerted Briar to the fact that someone was stomping downstairs. It was Posy, wearing one of the inn's dressing gowns and a pair of slippers that were as snug on her tiny feet as ballet flats. She was bellowing into her mobile phone, complaining to whoever was on the other end of the line about being trapped and about wanting to push her mother down the stairs. She barked one final profanity at the front desk before storming out into the snow. Briar watched her go.
I need a better signal. I can't hear you. Hold on.
It was the last thing Briar ever heard her say. A few hours later, just as the sun started to make an appearance, Briar put Flute on the leash for his regular morning walk. She put on her coat and boots and set out into the cold. There had been no further snowfall or noise after last night's disturbance, and as Briar shut the inn door behind her, she noticed Posy's solitary footsteps were still fresh and clearly visible in the white blanket laid out before her. "Careful, boy," Briar said, steering Flute away from the lonely trail of prints. "Something's up." "Footprints going out," she murmured. "None coming back." It was true. The footprints were as obvious as stains on a white carpet. And there were none returning to the inn. Briar set off towards the woodland, clutching Flute's lead and making sure not to step on Posy's tracks as she followed alongside them. If Posy Lennox was trapped in a gorge or suffering from hypothermia somewhere, the prints were Briar's best clue. "Don't disturb a possible crime scene," she said to Flute. Flute made a grumbling sound. "It could very well be a crime scene," Briar retorted, tugging the stubborn hound along. "I know you don't like the snow on your paws, but she might be in trouble." "Some assistant," Briar thought. They headed further onward. When Flute started making suspicious snuffles, Briar knew they were close, though she was nervous about what lay ahead. She was right to be. As they neared the edge of the woods, Flute barked and Briar spotted her. Posy Lennox, face down in the snow. A police officer tried to force a cup of tea and a shock blanket into Briar's hands. "Strange," Briar said to Flute, bending down to wrap the foil blanket around the basset hound instead. "I'm not in shock. I was pretty certain we were going to find what we found." Flute gave one small bark in consolation. "Her phone was missing," Briar mused thoughtfully, meeting Flute's quizzical gaze. "Did you notice? She was on the phone when she stormed out, and I didn't see it anywhere on her when I checked for a pulse." Posy's palm had been open, as if still clutching the mobile. Only Briar had found no trace of it. Renee Lennox could be heard wailing in the dining room. Marianne, looking pale and drawn and shocked, was trying to calm her down. The front desk manager was hiding from the police in the small inn staff room, muttering about Posy Lennox ruining everyone's Sunday. "You were the last person to see her alive, Jean-Claude," Briar said to the employee, matter-of-factly. His face turned a strange puce colour.
"Maybe, but she stormed off into the snow late at night. I didn't follow her."
No, Briar thought. That was certainly true. She had not seen or heard him follow Posy, and there were no other tracks in the snow. A quick glance down at Jean-Claude's feet confirmed they were at least a size 12. A lack of prints in the snow leading up to Posy's body was certainly puzzling. Briar looked over at the police detective who was trying to comfort Marianne and Renee. He had come on foot as the snow was still too heavy to drive through. The prints leading to the spot where Briar found Posy had been taped off. "Do you think he'll notice the right things?" she asked Flute, her voice a doubtful whisper. Flute gave her a look that said, "They never ask the right questions." Briar nodded in agreement and turned back to Jean-Claude. The detective could spend this valuable time getting people teas and coffees. Briar was going to find out if foul play was involved. If the detective was going to lurk around a snowed-in inn, he clearly did not believe Posy Lennox had collapsed from natural causes. Therefore, everyone at the inn was a suspect. "So what do we know?" Briar said to Flute as they sat upstairs. "Posy has a massive argument with Renee at 3 a.m. She storms downstairs on her mobile phone, shouts at reception, and then heads off into the snow. No sign of injury, just rudeness." Flute's ears were draped across the carpet as he rested his head on his front paws and stared up at Briar, listening. She heads off on her phone, trying to get a better signal. No other guests were signed out.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.